the first time the show has been done in this manner, so you all are the first to see it in this way. I typically do the show all the way through with all of the now 8 characters that I have, but this is a different way of doing it, and so I praise the Lord for this new format that's just for you. Just for you. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much for your presence in our lives, Lord. We thank you that you are an intentional God. Lord, we love you so much, and we're grateful for this time. God, we thank you for having ministered already throughout this service, Lord, and we just ask that you will speak through me. Holy Spirit, have your way in this place. Speak to us on this night. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I love the Lord. I love the Lord, and I love how faithful he is, even when our faith wavers, and when we find ourselves in different situations, he shows himself strong. And I know that the 3 characters that, this is Women's Missionary Union, and there are a variety of characters that really do address missions. I do portray a character that you'll see tomorrow, doing human trafficking, and a lot of major issues that when we go out on the mission field where we come across. And so if you're asking, well, why did you do these 3 characters, Morgan? But the reason the Lord, I believe, put this on my heart is because tomorrow we're going to talk about our mission work. We're going to talk about serving and discipleship. But today we're going to talk about the missionary, the women,
yes.
You, me, us. That's what we're going to talk about. What was the first character? What was her issue?
Cancer.
Cancer. She's sick. Somebody said something about her husband feeling neglected in her marriage, lonely in her marriage, right? And so she's dealing with bitterness as a result of that. How was the second character that you saw? She was molested. How old was that particular character?
9.
How old was she really?
30.
39. So that unforgiveness, that pain, that hurt, living there for 30 years. And what was the last character that she said? Single. She wanted a man. Right? She wanted her husband, her Boaz. She was praying and believing. She was lonely, which is a very real issue. And what I want us to look at this evening as we focus on our theme scripture and connecting the dots and looking at that there are many Christians that are hurting. There are many of us even here that are dealing with things, and we have to address those things so we can be as effective as God would have us to be on the mission field. Amen?
Amen?
We find ourselves seeing in the body of Christ, like I mentioned, hurting people, where you see bitter believers, you see selfish saints, you see anointed alcoholics, you see depressed disciples, right? And so we have to talk about these issues in order to bring healing to us, and then so we can bring the healing power of the Lord to others. And so that's what I really want us to think about on this evening, and allow the Lord to minister to us so we can go out and effectively minister to the world. Amen?
Amen.
So WMU Mission, I read on the website, is we believe missions is a lifestyle. Somebody say lifestyle.
Lifestyle.
Lifestyle. And it goes on to say, therefore, we provide missions education resources for all age levels, from preschoolers to senior adults. Whatever your age or stage in life, we have mission resources for you. Through missions, others may hear of Jesus, the giver of eternal life. That's a powerful mission statement. It's a powerful mission statement. And this evening, we're going to focus on, we believe missions is a lifestyle, my lifestyle. And as we know, if you look at Galatians 2:20, the scripture in the King James Version reads, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself to me. This evening, we're going to focus on this second part of the verse, specifically where it says, I live by the faith of the Son of God. So for a subtitle, our theme is connecting the dots, but the title for this particular message is, how to make my faith real to me.
how to make my faith real to me. I praise God because He knows us so well. He knows that we are, and Brother John was talking about Martha's and Mary's. He knows that unfortunately, sometimes instead of dealing with our real issues, it's easier to get busy, right? So I'm going to join another Sunday school class. I'm going to take an office position in the PTA. I'm going to start my own little small group ministry. I'm going to do this. I'm going to go on a mission. I'm going to do this, 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 this. And we mask what's really going on. Sometimes we want to get so busy so we can avoid ourselves. What's really happening with us. And tonight, you have gotten away, my sisters and some of my brothers in here. You have gotten away from your husbands, from your children, from your family members, from your church. You have gotten away from all the people that are pulling on you and all the things that you want to pull on you, some of us, just for this moment where tonight is about you and God. Amen. Amen. I want you to look at your sister and say, it's about me.
It's about me.
Not away. We have got away. So our challenge tonight is where we reconcile our service and ourselves and bringing those two together. Now, can I be honest with you ladies? I have been saved since I was 6 years old. I'm 29 now, and I've been saved a very long time. And as a six-year-old, I was very sincere about my faith. I went to Hampton Christian High School, middle school. One of my teachers, Mrs. Flowers, is here. There she is. And I was sincere about it. And many of you, and all of us in here, are sincere about our faith with the Lord, in the Lord. But I went through a major crisis in my life, and that crisis almost annihilated my faith. And as a result of that experience, I recognized the importance of us being real. That sometimes we have to stop masking, putting makeup over, putting our heels over, putting our smile over, curling our hair over it, and just have to be real with the Lord. So if we want to reconcile our service with ourselves, where we are the mission field, then we have to be real. It's time out for us faking it. It's time out for us pretending. We have to be honest with God. If you're hurting, be honest with God. God knows anyway. So we have to take a moment to say, Lord, this is how I feel. We cannot be ran by our emotions, but our emotions are still a part of what we deal with. And so in order for God to fix anything, we have to acknowledge that thing in the first place. So the first step, if we really want to reconcile ourselves and our service, we want to make ministry real in our lives, we want to make it real, our faith, make that real, we have to be honest. Say, be honest.
Be honest.
It's practical. So let's talk about how we're being honest. God, I am lonely in my marriage. I don't like this, Lord. I've never seen divorce in my family, but my husband is talking about leaving me. What am I supposed to do? That's honest. God, my children are rebellious, and I'm leading the children's church. That is honest. God, I'm dealing with some pill addiction. That is honest. Let's not pretend like things aren't happening, because they are. God, I don't know how to handle my mother's Alzheimer's. That's honest. Lord, I'm scared. I got a diagnosis that I wasn't expecting, Lord. I'm nervous about this. What am I supposed to do? That is honest. God does not want us to pretend. He loves us. We're his daughters. He wants us to be honest with him and say, Lord, I don't know what I'm doing. Sometimes that is where we are. And it's okay. It's okay to be honest with your Creator. If you can't be honest with anybody, you should be honest with God. I'm scared, I'm frustrated, I'm worried. This is where I am right now. If we want to see any type of manifestation of God's power in our life, we have to acknowledge the parts that are messed up that we need him to fix. But if we pretend like everything's okay, then what is it there for him to fix? So what is it? Be what?
Honest.
Honest. Be honest with God. The next part of what we need to do in order to reconcile our service and ourselves is know that God is bigger.
know that he is bigger. Oh man, we serve a mighty, powerful, loving God. I mean, the creator of the universe. We're talking about the kings of kings and the Lord of lords. We're serving God. So no matter what we're honest to him about what's happening in our lives, knowing that he is bigger than all of those things, that is why David, when he faced Goliath, he was not scared. Because he knew that it didn't matter what kind of giant Goliath looked like, that God was bigger and better and stronger and mightier than 10,000 giants or Goliath. That's the God he knew he served. So he faced that giant with confidence. And so when we are honest about what we're dealing with and we remember that God is bigger. God is bigger than my dying marriage. God is bigger than my children. God is bigger than my health issue. God is bigger than my insecurities. God is bigger. He is bigger. He is bigger. And if we focus on the fact that he is bigger, then we're not overwhelmed by our issues. He is bigger. Can you say it with me? He is bigger.
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 Hallelujah. I'm glad that we serve a God that is bigger.
Amen.
In addition to us remembering that God is bigger, we have to know that God cares about us. We have to know that he is a present help. See, sometimes we as believers, we've been in church a long time, and we've heard a lot of Bible stories, and we marvel at what God did in their lives, that he is able to do for them. But we got to know that he can do it for us.
Amen.
That he cares about you. He knows how many hairs are on your head. That is a personal thing. That he loves you. That he has captured every tear that you have ever cried in your entire life. That he cares about you. And that he wants to help you not just then, but right now. See, a part of our scripture here in Galatians 2:20 tells us that I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself to me. If he did not care about you, he would not have given himself for you. This is I'm not a mother yet, I'm engaged, I'm getting married in December. Praise the Lord. But with that, I was with a mother and her child, and this mother had ordered her daughter, she was a kid, 9 years old, she ordered her a kid's meal. With the kid's meal, they came a kid's Sprite. And the girl had a fit that she did not get an adult-sized Sprite. And she was crying profusely over the fact that she got a kid's Sprite. I'm not a mom, so my tolerance is a little different. I'm just like, it's the same. What in the world? You know, I didn't say that, but I definitely got that. And I know that sometimes how God sees us, like if I was her mom, I would feel like I literally gave my body to have you and you want to cry about a kid's rap, right? So, but I know that's probably how God looks at us. You know, I gave my life for you. Do you really think I don't care about you right now? I died for you before you even existed. Of course I care about what's happening in your life currently. I am God. You matter to me. In Deuteronomy, I love this scripture, Deuteronomy 33:26, it says, he rides across the heavens to help you. Can you imagine that imagery of God riding across the heavens to say, hey, let me help you. I have you. He cares about you, and he is a present help. Amen. The next part of us reconciling our service and ourselves is work your faith. What do you mean, Lord, work your faith? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, right? When I went through my crisis, when I was thinking, like, all hope is lost, I don't know what's going to happen in my world, I had to get to the word. I had to crawl to the word of God, and I had to find my purpose and God's promise and his word, because If I believe, if I'm a Christian, a believer, saint, whatever you want to call it, if that's who I am, I believe that God cannot lie. Right? Can we agree with that? God cannot lie. So since God cannot lie, then what is in his word is true. And since what is in his word is true, that is what I have to stand on. When I feel like I'm wavering, when I'm doubting, when I'm scared, I have to stand on his word. And so my suggestion to you, my sisters, is once you're real with God about where you are, what's going on in your world, and you know that, okay, God, you're bigger, God, you care, you get in your word and you find out where the scriptures related to what I'm dealing with right now. Because whatever his word says, I can stand on that, knowing that my God cannot lie. So if it's in his word, then my trust and my hope is in him. And that is how you begin to work your faith. So you look at your situation, your dying marriage, and say, well, Lord, I see in your word that you raised Lazarus from the dead. And if you could breathe life into Lazarus, you could breathe life into my marriage. God, I feel sick in my body, but your word says that by your stripes I am healed. And since I know that you cannot lie, manifest that power in my body. God, I know that my kids are acting crazy right now. But your word says that the train of a child in the way that you go, when they get old, they will not depart. So God, I trust that my child, by the time they're 80 years old, they're going to serve me.
When they see your love, when they see allowing Jesus to manifest his power in your life. Will you choose not to gossip? You choose not to worry. And it's a daily thing. It's one step at a time. Today, God, I choose to live for you. Today, God, I choose to be your representative. Today, God, I will allow my faith to be real. And people are going to want to know who you serve and how they can be good news too. Amen. God bless you, my sisters, and I look forward to seeing you.
You're the parents. I knew that somebody was mighty happy back here.